First, I want to say thank you to all of you who showed up on a night that had some questionable weather. We weren't sure what we were going to have, so thank you. I also want to thank the board for inviting me to speak. I'm very honored and thankful and blessed for this opportunity. It's nice to be able to speak close to home. I like that. So, quick history. National Day of Prayer was started in 1952 by President Truman. In 1988, President Reagan made it a specific day, the first Thursday of every May. So that's why we're here today. The theme this year is Lift Up the Word and Light Up the World. That comes from 2 Samuel chapter 22, verses 29 to 31. You, Lord, are my lamp. The Lord turns my darkness into light. With your help, I can advance against a troop. With my God, I can scale a wall. As for God, his way is perfect. The Lord's word is flawless. He shields all who take refuge in him. As I was preparing and thinking about what am I going to speak, I asked the Lord, I'm like, what do you want me to talk about? And I was reminded of the phrase, what would Jesus do? And that evolved into, what would our founding fathers do if they were faced with the current challenges in America? So first, we're going to look at those founding fathers. We're going to start with George Washington. George was considered a very respectful man, but he also had a temper. He kept it under control most of the time, but when he didn't, it didn't end well. Despite his flaws, he became president and served two terms. His vice president was John Adams. John was a Massachusetts lawyer. He had a completely different personality than Washington. He was deemed a bit persnickety. He was not very popular, and accordingly, he only served as one term as president. He had a cousin, second cousin, Samuel Adams. Samuel was quite different than his cousin. Samuel was known as a firebrand politician. He was considered, he was just very fiery. He was known for probably having organized the Boston Tea Party, and he also stirred up a lot of opposition against the British. I kind of think that if he was here today, I think I'd like him. I think he'd be a lot of fun. Benjamin Franklin. What a man. He was a diplomat. He was a scientist. He was an inventor. He was a printer. Brilliant mind, and yet his formal education stopped at the age of 10. But who would have known? Alexander Hamilton. Now, this is where it gets fun. This is where it's like there's nothing new under the sun. Same things happening today that happened back then in the 1700s. So Alexander's mother had left her husband, her first husband. He was spending her family fortune. She was not happy with that, so she left him. She had an affair. Alexander was the result of that. She hadn't exactly gotten a divorce, so there was a bit of a scandal. So he was born into a scandal. She divorced. She did marry his father. 10 years later, that dad bails on the family. And then about 2 years after that, the mother passes away. So now we have Alexander Hamilton. He's orphaned and poor and 12 years old. But despite all of those challenges, he rose to a very powerful position in our government. He was a Treasury Secretary under Washington. Very powerful. He resigned his position, but remained a very close advisor and a very powerful person. John Jay. Who was he? He was a Supreme Court Justice. He was our first Supreme Court Justice. Back then, they didn't have a nice, big, fancy building to hold court. They had circuit courts. They had to ride the circuit and go to the courts. Well, he decided he didn't like that very much, so he resigned from that position and in 1795, he became the governor of New York. Thomas Jefferson, he was president under John Adams. For a time, at the beginning, they were friends. Then they became enemies. Toward the end of their life, they did reconcile, which is a good thing. Jefferson was gifted in writing, but not in speaking. He was not a good speaker, but he was a brilliant writer. So, ironically, they both died on the same day. Some of you probably know this, July 4th, 1826, about 5 hours apart, I read. So it's interesting that they were enemies. They reconciled and were still reconciled at their death. Guess what caused their friendship to derail? They both had the same goal, but they had different ideas on how to get there. Does that sound like America today? Yes, it does. Last but not least, we're going to talk about James Madison. Here's another example that there is nothing new under the sun. James Madison married a woman who was widowed. She had one son. They never had children together. That son grew up to be quite a disappointment. He was wayward. He was a womanizer. He was a drinker. He was a gambler. James Madison spent a significant amount of their wealth bailing him out. Today we would call him an enabler. Back then they didn't have that word. But he was truly an enabler, and he did that to keep Dolly Madison from finding out what her son really was like. And unfortunately, he spent so much of their fortune doing that he left her in not great financial condition at his death. Some of you might be sitting there going, what does all of this have to do with the Founding Fathers and what they do today? Well, point being, the Founding Fathers back then were no different than we are. They were a very diverse group. They obviously all did not get along. They didn't all have the same ideas, but they worked together in unity for the good of the country. They put aside their own personal agendas. They put aside their own beliefs. They worked together for the good of America. And that is what they would do if they were here today. Item number one, they would pray. AJ said it well. Without God in this country, we are doomed. We have got to pray for this country. America has got to return to God. He is our only hope. We have got to pray for unity in this country. We have to pray for our federal, our state, our local officials. I don't care if a person is running for dog catcher. You pray for them. We are in desperate need of prayer because, like AJ said, we've done a great job of taking God out of everything in this country, and we see what is caused. I mean, we see what that has caused. You reap what you sow, and we are sowing a lot of evil things. The next thing that they would do is encourage unity. Unity is what our country needs more. I won't say more than anything. Our country needs God, but second only to God, our country needs unity. And I'm going to read a scripture. Matthew 12:25, every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. It doesn't get any plainer than that. A couple of days ago, I had the privilege of interviewing for our podcast a gentleman that has become a friend. He's a former Israeli ambassador. He lives in Jerusalem. And we were talking about a number of things going on in Israel. He was telling me about what they have for their, it's basically their Memorial Day and their Independence Day. Their Memorial Day is the day before their Independence Day. And on that day, it is very somber. It's not like American Memorial Day. It is a day commemoration for those who have given their life for their country. And this just gave me cold chills. He said, there is a 2-minute siren that goes off at a specific time of the day. And when that does, everybody in that entire country, they stop what they're doing. If you're driving your car on a freeway, you stop your car, you get out, and you come to attention for the 2 minutes that that siren is going off, and you remember those who have died for Israel. That kind of incredible history is instilled from even the youngest of children, and that has fostered great patriotism that has contributed to their success and their prosperity. America should take a lesson from that. Patriotism is important, and that's another thing that is sadly lacking in America. Lastly, is work. Our founding fathers worked. They put aside their differences, they rolled up their sleeves, and they got the job done. You may not, and when I'm talking about unity and working together, I'm not talking about just within a given political party. I'm talking about working together as Americans. We are all Americans. Have any of you ever seen our country so divided, ever? No, it's never been like this. That has got to be stopped because it will tear this country apart. And I personally am going to do everything I can to stop that. That's why I started Awake to Truth Ministry. I was angry. I'm not one to run for office. That's not what I'm called to do. But I am called to speak and to share truth. And that's what this is all about. So our founding fathers, if they were here today and faced with these things, they would do those three things. They would encourage us. They would say, pray for your country. Bring unity into this country. You can't go forward without unity and work. I love the saying, work like it all depends on you and pray like it all depends on God. That takes care of pretty much all of the business that needs to happen. So that concludes my message. I thank you very much for this opportunity. It's been great to be here. Thank you.
That grace. Oh. saved thus far. And grace will be given me. Everybody stand. We're going to sing this song together. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night when the light from above, from the mountains and the prairies and the oceans, white will fall. God bless America, my home sweet home. God
Give a big hand for Mike.